The past year has been such a struggle, and I've been too overwhelmed since Red came out to say anything, but I didn't know if I'd be blessed enough to be here for this, and it's been such an incredible, magical, happy, free, confused, lonely, sacred experience. Red means everything to me, and the re-recording has reminded me why it's so powerful and why it's beloved to me, and how many beautifully it represents Taylor as an artist and a person. Her vivid storytelling, her empathetic heart, the way she weaves stories in her songs, the way each album is a work of art.
Oh, man.
I'm so proud of her and beyond grateful to have been able to see all of this, to watch music history being made with All Too Well, all of it. The gifts she shares with us each and all, the love we share for her work is really powerful, and I have no doubt it will last forever. She's reclaiming her legacy and her voice and bringing us along on the road of recapturing it and healing however we can. It's more than I could ever say.
Oh my God.
I did not say enough yet. This release will live in my heart forever. I'll remember it all. Heart, 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 heart.
Word. Well, in case you haven't figured it out, this is Music Sucks and I Want to Die. We are back after an entire almost year of not doing anything with our lives.
Well, this past year has been a struggle for me.
Really, what we were waiting for is the guiding light, the scion of Taylor Swift to come out and release all of her old albums again so that we could have positivity and delightful lyrics and well woven lines of melody and beautiful
incredible
music.
Magical, happy, free, confused, lonely, sacred.
Wow, Jesus, what great. Yeah, so we're back. I'm Jake.
The boy's back in town.
Yeah, he's Matt. And basically we're gonna be talking about Taylor Swift today and why she's re-releasing all her old albums again.
We're not actually really gonna talk about why.
Yeah, it's actually pretty simple why.
Yeah, we're more just gonna see if there was a reason, any point to doing so.
Musically
speaking.
Spoiler, no. But it's a little more complicated than that, so we're going to get into it. I guess we should kind of just iron out the why she did it real quick, though.
Well, first things first, we got a new gift from our sponsors over at Steel Reserve.
Yeah. Oh, is it Steel Reserve Tiki Series Island Punch? I'm dressed appropriately
for
the occasion.
Yep, just in time for summer.
Yep.
Oh, boy. Let's
cheers.
See how these are.
Oh, boy. I hope Mike picked that up.
Yeah, it's pretty disgusting.
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Thanks, Stuart.
It's not that bad, though. There are worse flavors.
There are worse flavors.
All right.
So, Jake, why did she re-record all her albums? Well, she's only done two so far. But why is she planning on re-recording all her albums?
Well, long story short, she was on a label with some guy, and that guy sold the label to some other guy she doesn't like.
Yeah, Scooter.
Yeah, Scooter.
Scooter Braun.
Yeah. So she sold it. It got sold to Scooter Braun, who she doesn't like because Scooter Braun has ties with Kanye and Justin Bieber, both of whom apparently bullied Taylor Swift in her music career. Well, I can't remember. Is Kanye?
I'm gonna let you finish.
Was that Taylor?
That was Taylor.
Okay,
yeah.
That was Taylor. Okay. Yeah. So that did happen, and I'm sure Kanye's a huge asshole. Obviously.
What?
But yeah, so she doesn't like Kanye and Justin Bieber, and Scooter Braun apparently is also an asshole. So what she's doing is she's re-recording track by track all of the albums she released under that label.
Yes.
So she can have control of her own music streaming, royalty rights, whatever comes way that way. And then she had control over like her publishing, all that shit.
Yes. And this is the second one she's done and perhaps the most anticipated of them all.
Oh.
Maybe. I don't really know.
I don't know.
But it's definitely made waves. It's the one she did before, I remember not being as big of a deal. I mean, people were like, oh, new Taylor. But like, well, not even new Taylor.
Yeah.
But for some reason, this album, people are like, whoa. And
well, I mean, it does have, like, what, three or four of her biggest songs like,
yeah,
ever.
Yeah, it definitely
so
does.
That's probably mostly it.
It's just a really important album to a lot of people my age.
Yeah.
Because I remember I was feeling 22.
Okay.
Because I was 22.
Okay.
When 22 came
actually,
out.
Actually, you were, weren't you?
Yep.
Like, really, that year. Wow, 2012.
Taylor Swift and I have almost the same birthday. She's, like, 2 weeks after me.
Okay.
Yeah, so.
You guys are the same sign?
No.
Oh.
Because I'm Cups. Last day, man.
Last day.
Last day, Scorp.
So what's after Scorp?
Sag.
Oh, Sag. Word.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so anyway.
So, come in next week for astrology. All right. So, re-record the albums. Not quite sure. We couldn't really find this, but if legally there was a reason they had to be so similar or not.
Or so, yeah.
like
what specifically they had to change to be able to re-release this. I'm assuming actually it could just be that they re-recorded track by track.
That
regardless
might be
of
it.
The similarity of outcome.
Yeah, but I'm also wondering, I said that would make more sense. And then as we'll get into these songs and listening to them, is it, did she intend to not make them that different just so fans would like them? Or is that a legal thing? Or is that, I don't know.
There are a couple of tracks that are slightly different.
There are.
And one of them is quite a bit different, actually. It's almost like a remix. And we'll get to that later. But yeah, the tracks are very, very, very similar. And to quote Pitchfork, trying to find the difference between them is like basically a new version of a headphone fidelity test. But that being said, we did listen to it a couple times each, and we did find stuff.
We did, we did. Also interesting to note, too, before we get into this, that apparently from now on, this version is going to be played on, like, radio and streaming and whatever. Interesting.
Yeah, I mean, that's just, you know, the modern culture supporting someone who's, like, you know, trying to have full control over their music, and it's kind of a blow against the industry, I guess. If that's even true, though, because where I found that was a shitty website called, like, AmericanSongwriter.com, where half the article was written by AI. We'll get into that later. But they were basically like all the radio stations, iHeartRadio specifically, who controls like fucking everything.
I think it's like the only radio station at this point.
yeah, iHeartRadio just bought every frequency on FM band.
Well, I did see too, like all the hits from this, the previous hits from this album got on charts again with the new versions.
Yeah.
So someone's listening to them and they're pushing them or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
But
so, I mean, I guess that's good. Why not?
Why not?
Why
anyway,
not?
Do you want to just jump in?
Let's jump in.
All right. We're going to start with State of Grace, the opening track. Now, we talked about this yesterday and you were like, pop album's weird because why does this have to, like, there's no reason this should be the first song or anything like that.
Yeah.
I disagree. I was thinking about it more.
Okay.
I think this is, Red was really her, like, turning point from pop country to
pop.
And I don't
but
know.
But she still has, like, banjos in the sound. So
she does. Well, I mean, this was, you know, it's a mix. Dude. Fusion.
Oh, fusion.
But I think it's a really good opening track for that reason, that it sort of is so, like, epic.
Okay.
In a way, it's a lot different
I think it's
you
like
know
a,
what I mean?
I think it's like a, in a way, I thought it was almost good in a way because it's like an album opener kind of song.
Yeah, it is. It
in
is.
An album that doesn't have an album flow at all and
it's
it doesn't have any ideas behind that. But let's just go ahead and listen to it.
So we're going
to
start with the original one.
Yep.
Here's State of Grace. Initial observations. I actually do like this song.
Yeah.
It reminds me, like a lot of the guitars that kind of reminds me of U2.
Yes.
Sort of like that stadium big.
Yeah. The guitars have reverb on them. Yeah. They're playing nice clean lines, you know.
As I think will become apparent when we listen to the next version, I can't remember exactly how you said it, but it's, there's a lot going on, but it's very like mixed well together and like wide, even though it's like not, it's not like they're separated. It's just
everything has like, well, how I put it, I guess, was like everything has this blend. Everything feels like it's part of each other. As the next version we're going to hear, the re-release, it sounds just a little more separated. Although I will say, I haven't listened to it on these headphones before.
Okay,
you know, I listened to it on my earbuds, those speakers and those speakers. I mean, it sounds pretty much the same, but it is nice having like your headphones on because you get a really good sense of space without being interrupted by your actual shitty apartment acoustics. And honestly, it sounds even better than I remember. It's like
it does, yeah.
It's really well. Everything's really well connected. The guitars fill out a bunch of space without that reverb. I'm pretty sure there's like some trickery with that reverb, like they're reinserting it somehow.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. I mean, who knows? There's like 80 different plugins per track on here or something.
But. Yeah. There's like four buses per guitar. Yeah. Whatever. Who the fuck knows?
It sounds good though. It sounds really,
really
good.
Really good. Yeah.
All right.
Should we jump into the new one?
State of Grace, Taylor's version,
2021.
Not that big of a difference. No. I don't know if the average person not really paying attention will notice it's different at all.
Yeah, especially since the average person is listening on their phone speakers.
Yes.
And that case is going to be exactly the same. I'm pretty sure what I was saying holds true in that this new version, it's a different style of mixing, I would guess. It's more separated. Yes. You can hear every part more individually. Like, you can clearly hear, like, the two guitars panned either side. Mm-hmm. You hear that little synth bubbly thing on the left.
One thing I was noticing about that too, because like the guitars are a lot more prominent in the mix in a way, or at least more noticeable. And it kind of, the problem with re-recording the exact same parts is that they are more prominent, but you can kind of listen that they're not interesting. I mean, they're not bad lines or anything, but they're not like a focus hook line.
So the fact that they're all blended kind of,
it works really well in a mix like that. But when it's just like in your face, it's like, that line kind of sucks. Yeah. I mean, it's not. It's just me.
It doesn't add much to the song other than like a texture, which is how it was treated in the original. And they were probably, I don't know if they were going for the same thing. Like, who knows?
It sounds pretty much the same. Well, the feedback was a little different.
Yeah, the feedback's a little different. I mean, also another thing to point out is that Taylor Swift is 10 years older.
Yes.
And her voice still sounds great. I like it. But it definitely doesn't have that same, like, really young, like not crystalline, but like really bright. Her voice is not less bright in this version.
It is. I think this might be a nostalgia factor for me. But, you know, if she recorded this album when she was like 22 or whatever, and new phase of her career, you know, new sound,
new label,
and especially like this, I don't know, like this song and 22 when we talk about that. To me, it's like it's a young person's song, kind of, and redoing it, you know, it sounds like she's been playing it on the road for 10 years, and it's like not bad. It just kind of loses some of that spark in a weird way.
Okay.
Like, she doesn't quite sound in the right mindset of it. You know what I mean?
I could hear that. Obviously, I don't have that same connection. I did not listen to this album until like 3 weeks ago when we decided to do this topic. But yeah, I did pick up on that. Her voice isn't quite right anymore for this particular song. And I guess that probably has something to do with it. I couldn't quite put my finger on it. I definitely don't think it sounds bad.
No, it sounds good.
It's definitely really interesting, good, too. Yeah. Like, almost like the contrast is kind of interesting.
It's definitely, she's more mature.
Yeah.
And that, you can take that how you want, I guess. Mm-hmm. On this song, it doesn't really matter. I think on some of the ballads, it maybe works better.
Yeah.
On some of the popular ones, maybe not.
Yeah. To be honest, though, on the other tracks, I'm not sure I'd notice the difference between her voices that much, the 10 years apart.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, this song, you can really you can really tell if you're looking for it. I would say that she's older.
It has, I think you, the way you put it too, like it, the original one kind of pushes.
Yeah, it drives. I want to say, when I was listening to that just now, I want to say that's due to like, this, the newer version sounds like more, the way they treat the drums with the reverb on them and like the big toms circulating around, right? I want to say that's treated more like an indie band would be.
Yes.
I don't know how exactly I would put that into terms, but the original seemed like there was just less reverb and there was a little louder on the drums, maybe.
It just hit.
It just hit harder, and we're not going to try quantifying that.
Well,
because
it's like we're saying, it's super subtle stuff.
Yeah.
You don't really notice unless you play back-to-back over and over again.
Right, like we did,
like
annoyingly.
Like some losers. Yeah. I know.
God, what lives we have. Man, how shitty of lives we have to come back to our podcast a year later and then talk about this.
Whose idea was this? I don't know if you have anything else to say on that one.
Yeah, I do. Okay. I have one more thing. Mm-hmm. Basically... this goes for both versions, but mostly the original. And that, like, basically, pop production's really good, man. It's like, insane.
Oh, yeah.
As someone who's, like, trying to get into production and have been for the past year and not done anything, I sit down in a mix, and, like, it just sounds like garbage, and I have no idea why. And I try to fix it, and I can't. Like, this just sounds so incredible. But specifically in the pads and, like, the way that the space is, like, filled out. Like on a stereo image.
Oh yeah,
it's disgusting.
It's disgusting. Like every subtle little thing just really adds up.
Mm-hmm. And that's where, you know, they have like 120 tracks, I'm sure, whatever. But that's what I feel like the difference is between like a mega ultra star like a Taylor Swift and like the next level or two levels down in terms of like funding and stuff like that.
Percy Jake, I'm more of a rocker.
Oh yeah,
and I like my more stripped down kind of live mixes like Imagine Dragons would do.
Burp. I mean, Imagine Dragons pop mixes are really good, dude. I don't know.
What nah, man, it's just okay. Just four guys in the studio with their totally instruments that they definitely play. It's really laying it down, spreading the gospel of rock.
Yeah, the good music, man.
Oh, man.
Bringing it back.
Oh man.
So anyway, that's pretty much all I have to say about this. This song's like definitely got its retro vibe to me for sure.
Yeah, I like that one. Good album opener. I want to go to 22 real quick just to keep bringing it up.
Yep.
I really just want to listen to her vocal delivery because to me, I think this is like the biggest vocal difference between versions.
Okay.
So
let's do it. One thing that came to mind though, the more of this music we play, the more we're going to get fucked in the ass by copyright.
Yay. Here we go.
She did just release this shit, you know? So we're gonna be...
No one's going to listen to this episode. We're fine.
Dude, the algorithm's always listening, dude. I know, dude. They do. It's always listening. All right, play it up. Let's do it.
All right, here's 22 OG version.
OG.
If you hit play, it works better.
Okay, cool.
Like a perfect night to dress up like hipsters and make fun of our exes. It feels like a perfect night for breakfast at midnight to fall in love with strangers. Yeah, we're happy, free, confused, and lonely at the same time. It's miserable and magical. About the deadlines, it's time. Uh oh. I don't know about you, but I'm feeling 22. Everything will be alright if you keep me next to you. You don't know about me, but I'll bet you want to. Everything will be alright if we just keep dancing like we're 22.
Song makes me happy.
This song's good. Never underestimate the value of a good tambourine.
I know, right? Taylor Swift's a huge dork, obviously. I mean, I think that's part of her charm, too.
Yeah, exactly. She's the girl next door, right?
The time she tried to be, like, serious pop, like, bad bitch, it was terrible. No one liked it. So she's a dork, and... I mean, it's pop music, but I think that she does have some authenticity to her
songs.
And I know she is very involved in the writing and everything. it's to me, I was like, yeah, 22, maybe because I was 22 when I heard that. I know. I keep bringing it back. But no, just the way she delivers the line, her voice is kind of like obnoxious.
Yeah, no.
And it's like almost a celebration of being obnoxious, yeah, and like lame. And but it's so cheesy that I would normally hate it, but I kind of like it, yeah, for some reason.
It's really good. I really like the way she was really over-exaggerating every word.
Yeah.
Especially in that first verse. I don't remember any of the lyrics anymore, but...
It feels like the perfect night.
Perfect. Like, even the CT at the end, like, perfect night. Yeah. And it's like, this is really good, very charming.
So, let's see how that sounds 10 years later.
Yay! All right.
It feels like a perfect night to dress up like hipsters and make fun of our exes. It feels like a perfect night for breakfast at midnight to fall in love with strangers.
So, Jake, I know you have a lot to say about the tambourine.
Yeah, so the tambourine is fucking buried. Damn, what happened?
It's between
sad
the buried tambourine.
Oh, nice. Okay. Cool, good joke.
I would say the mix on this one is pretty much identical, more or less.
Sure, the guitars, yeah. All sound the synths sound the same. Yeah, the drums are big.
Sounds so, like, passive. Yeah, this time.
Yes, I want to say, like, her EQ is much flat, or, like, it's not EQ, sorry. Her voice is just, like, less bright.
Yes.
This is the song you can really tell she has just less energy.
Yes, exactly.
Even, like, literally, specifically, right before the chorus hits the uh-oh. That's so lame.
Yeah, she's like, uh-oh.
Yeah, and then but on the original, you know she's, like, 22. She's like, uh-oh, right?
It sounds
she's
like,
fucking kicking ass.
And it's a missed opportunity, too, because I think this could have been interesting to do a song that you wrote when you were 22, about being 22, 10 years later.
That would be interesting.
And it's kind of a way, I don't know how you would do that necessarily, but it's like, make it more nostalgic maybe in a way or something. She just sounds bored.
You know? This song does sound like going through the motions, but also, you know, her voice is just older.
It is.
And like, little things like the uh-ohs are kind of weirder when you have more perspective, you know what I mean?
There is that, yeah. So I don't know if what you do, I mean, I guess you just don't fucking re-record the songs, but you have to, so it's... Yeah. I don't know. I just, all the other ones, it's like, meh, the voice sounds more or less the same to me. That one, it
seem like the energy's completely vampired out of there. It got sucked out, right?
Yeah.
It's pretty brutal. But then again, you know, it's not, we're way over exaggerating here.
Yes.
So, like, this is basically, let's reiterate the scope of what we're talking about, the adjectives we're using, the superlatives or whatever. This is just, it's just so much less energy. You have to take this as a microscope because
we are full of shit.
We're full of shit. Like, we're talking, like, on a scale that's, like, microscopic here, right? Like,
but that's why they pay us. That's why they give us
the Steel Reserve Island Punch sponsorship that we actually don't have that we want. Steel Reserve.
Thank you for not answering our emails or my phone calls. I went to your house.
Mr. Steel Reserve. Is that a
layout? He lives on 211 Malt Liquor Lane. Okay, moving on.
Yeah, so that song has less energy vis-a-vis the vocal delivery thing. Oh, man, that song's still good, though. Man.
I know. It's one of my faves, and I hate it. I like it so much.
It's pretty. I heard it in the fucking grocery store literally like 3 days
ago. Really?
Like, God damn it, I have to talk
was it
about
Taylor's
this.
Version?
I don't know.
Oh, shit.
I couldn't tell.
Well, Jay.
Because I'm such a pleb.
We should just stop fucking doing this video.
Well, the problem is, you know, when it gets interrupted by, please call line one.
We're
it's
all
the remix, the QFC
together.
Remix. Yeah.
Wicca, wicca.
Okay.
Do you want to go on your favorite song now?
Yes, I do. I do. Let's just play the original, and we're just going to get right into it.
All right, here
Fuck
we go.
Fuck it.
I remember when we broke up, the first time, saying this is it, I've had enough. Cause like we hadn't seen each other in a month when you said you needed space. What? Then you come around again and say, baby, I miss you and I swear I'm gonna change. Trust me, remember how that lasted for a day? I say, I hate you, we break up, you call me, I love you. Ooh, 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 we called it off again last night. But ooh, 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 this time, I'm telling you, I'm telling you, we are never, ever, ever getting back.
Why is that one so good, though?
I know. This song slaps hard as fuck. Oh, my God.
I love the production on that acoustic guitar intro, too.
Yeah, the reverse at the end.
It's trippy.
Yeah.
It's cool. It's very. It's kind of... I've never heard something quite like that.
Yeah.
Especially in this setting, you know?
It works really well, yeah. It's one of those things that could be super stupid if you fuck it up.
But good thing. Yeah, good thing.
Yeah, so... not much to say about this song other than it's amazing, really good production. You're right. She's singing this very much like a, you know, a down home girl. Like,
yeah. It wasn't like the 22 thing. It's just so like dorky.
Yeah. So it's very dorky. Yeah. Very, very charming. I guess.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's not going for the ultra, I'm a sexy pop star thing.
Yeah, that is kind of refreshing. Maybe, you know.
It is nice, yeah.
It is nice. I guess that's why she was definitely like when this album was out around here, like when I was teaching. Everyone was learning Taylor Swift songs.
Yeah.
Like, out of any other... I think there's plenty of other Katy Perry songs happening at the same time, but Taylor Swift was...
She was in?
Ridiculously huge.
Okay. See, I have no perspective on that because I had no life at the time, so it was great.
Well, I don't know about you, Jake.
But I'm feeling 32.
Oh.
All right, now let's just jump straight to the next one. There are differences, and they're, again, so unbelievably minute that it's so stupid to even try, and they might not even be true, and it might be all in my head. Let's fire it up.
Remember when we broke up the first time, saying this is it, I've had enough. Cause like we hadn't seen each other in a month when you said you needed space. What? Then you come around again and say, baby, I miss you and I swear I'm gonna change. Trust me, remember how that lasted for a day? I say I hate you, we break up, you call me, I love you. Ooh, 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 ooh.
Yeah, it's still pretty good.
Yeah, it is.
I have a couple things to say.
Of course you do. Tambourine involved?
Well, actually, so this song, it does have that little 16 note thing. It's not a tambourine. It's a little baby, a fake closed hi-hat, right? Mm-hmm. Same effect. You know, you play 16 notes in the place where you want the more chorus to happen.
The more chorus.
basically, you want the energy to drive a little more. And it's still there. It's possibly even just a little louder, which is great. I love that shit. For both versions, and actually this whole album, and Taylor Swift's probably pop in general, I guess, they don't fuck around on these intros, dude. Mm-mm. Two bars, you're done, you're into the song. We don't do nothing, we go straight for it. That's great.
Yeah.
This is a short little thought. Two bars is every song we've played so far.
It really is, intro, right? Yeah,
except for the State of Grace.
Yeah.
Which is the album opener, dude.
Oh, dude. Well, so if you go back to our episode number 2, Anatomy of an
That's
Album.
Right, which is now episode number 1, because we still...
Oh.
But yeah, so they don't fuck around on the intro. Let's get right to it. I'm going to talk about... I didn't notice much of a difference on the vocal stuff.
Yeah, mostly. I mean, again, I feel like the little I love you.
Yeah, just not quite there. And that might be in my head. I don't know. It might be in our heads.
Yeah, yeah.
One thing that I'm pretty sure is not in my head is that this chorus does not hit as hard.
It does not. Still not quite sure why exactly.
So this last time I listened really carefully to each drum, and the snare is actually like bigger and louder, and like it takes up more space, and like its reverb trails a little longer, maybe, I want to say. But somehow it's still, I guess it's the kick drum then that's missing. Like it's not as fat, doesn't take as much of the mix as it used to.
Yeah.
Because I love the big snare sound. It almost sounds like the big stupid whip crack, right? Mm-hmm. But it just, the chorus doesn't punch like it did. And I want to say the filter sweep and the buildup is not as present in the
mix. It's not. Yeah, I noticed that too.
Yeah. So like that, you know, the kind of thing. Mm-hmm. It's
the straw sucking.
The straw sucking, yeah. So
the straw sucker was out that day. So
yeah, they had to bring in the backup. Yeah. Cool. So you had to bring in the backup straw sucker, and you have to realize that, like, even still on that pre-chorus, I've really noticed like the same kind of thing we noticed on State of Grace, where it seemed like everything was just a little more disconnected from each other in a more like every instrument had its own little vibe, its own little section of the stereo image. And to me, it's just like it's not as cool, I guess. It's just different. It's not what, you know.
No one cares.
I don't like things that are different. I like the original.
I know. The more we talk about this, we're more of like a fucking crazy asshole, I feel like. Because it's just like, oh man, this doesn't matter at all.
None of this actually matters. And that's what, you know, we'll circle back to this point. Like, her releasing this album is probably a net positive for the music industry, herself.
Yes.
And, you know, whether or not the music has actually changed is almost immaterial based on how close it is. It
doesn't matter at all, really.
Yeah.
It doesn't. It's all like, good for her. She's a brilliant fucking marketing person.
Yes.
Like, so much shit she's done throughout the years. Like, she's always on top somehow.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. When we were talking, like, I was going through the Spotify dates and, like, I didn't realize this album was this old.
Yeah.
And, like, Taylor Swift has not really dropped off in popularity since then. Maybe, like, you know.
What was that? Like I was saying, that little bad bitch era she had that was kind of like,
sure.
But about a year ago, we talked about Folklore. Sure. And she released another album that year. Like, she's,
Folklore's its own situation. But
I didn't want to talk about this, but then I realized we had to talk about this.
Okay.
So as far as songs that are actually noticeably different, are you familiar with All Too Well?
Yes, I am. I have some notes on All Too Well.
Oh, yes, perfect. I have some notes as well.
Okay.
So All Too Well. Okay. So there's the original version, which I don't even think I knew it before, but I guess it was like a fan favorite. I don't think it was like a single or anything ever.
I never heard it till 3 weeks ago.
Yeah. So. I don't know. Apparently people liked it. So she obviously has the All Too Well re-recording, but then she released a 10-minute version. The original being, five and a half. She doubled the length.
Not sure I ever finished it then.
Oh, boy. 10-minute version. She made a video for it too and shit. It's, as far as music history being made, as our friend on Reddit said, it is the longest song to ever go number one.
Damn.
Yeah. If you go to her Spotify page on the album, millions of streams for every song.
Mm-hmm.
This one, by far the most, it's over 200 million plays.
What the fuck?
And it's 10 minutes. It's
damn, you're right. It's literally like, well, actually, it's number one right now in terms of popularity, but it's behind Blank Space.
Oh.
By three times.
Well, that's on a different album.
It is.
So.
You're talking about the albums.
Yeah.
But yeah, this song is really popular.
And also, it's behind Blank Space, which came out like 8 years ago.
Yes.
And this came out
It's already up to a third of the amount that Blank Space has. Fucking insane.
It's 10 minutes. Okay, so so this whole time we've been talking about like, what could she have done differently, blah, blah, blah.
What did she mean by trying to change this little thing? Is it different? Is it actually any different?
And now I feel like an asshole because the time she actually does try to do something different and bigger, it sucks!
We're about to poop it on it!
She doesn't know how to do long songs. Okay, so I'm just going to play a little bit of the original one just so we can kind of get the feel.
Yep.
I'm just going to like put it halfway in the chorus or verse or something.
Cool.
Let's see if I can... Ooh, ooh, ooh. Okay. I'm just going to skip ahead a little. How in your drawer even now. Disposition and my wide-eyed gaze. We're singing in the car, getting lost upstate. Autumn leaves falling down like pieces into place, and I can picture it after all these days. Anyway, that's the gist of it. That's pretty much it the whole time.
This song you can kind of tell is like more the bridge of the gap, right? Between her.
Yeah, exactly.
Country and pop.
I will say too, it's probably the most like, I like metaphors of her songs.
Yeah.
It's like, I mean,
she's going for the lyricism. That's
fine. It's fine. So that song to me already feels long when I was listening to it.
Yeah.
I was like, well, it's 5.5 minutes. So.
Yeah, it's long. I didn't mind it too much.
No, it's fine. It's just, I'm just kind of like, okay, I get it. It's a nice song or whatever.
It's her, you know, it's her attempt to be like, kind of expand her chops a little.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's totally great.
On the 10-minute version, I wrote down a time stamp every time I thought it was going to end. I have 6 different time spots of when I thought it was ending, and then it kept going.
I have a question. Was your first one about like 4 minutes and 30 seconds?
My first one was actually 3:54, but that might have been like the beginning of when I thought it should end, kind of thing.
Yeah, that was the beginning of like one of the weird vamps or something, right?
We'll talk about it. But so first of all, let's just play kind of like the same spot to get a feel.
It's mostly super the same. Tiny, super shitty differences we've been nitpicking like as fuck about.
Telling stories about you on the T-ball team. You told me about your past, thinking if you choose me.
It actually does, I think, have some less subtle production differences.
Yeah, no, I mean, the bass is huge.
Yeah, it is. It's actually pretty different. But more or less same vibe. I think this is actually one of the ones that sound better when she's 10 years older.
Yeah, no, that's what we were saying earlier. Yeah. When you have the songs that are more a little introspective, a little more... metaphorical, I guess. The lyrics are possibly a little deeper, whatever.
Yeah.
It gives a chance for her maturity to shine a little more.
So, first we're going to skip to 3:54 about. So I think this is where I felt it was like kind of really wrapping up. And we'll cut this out from the...
Cut it out. The more you have to edit later, bitch.
I know, right? I can't.
It just keeps going.
It keeps going.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, big final chorus. Then an even bigger final chorus. And then...
Honestly, it might have worked better with even more space if the song was even longer. Because, like, what happens when you have this kind of thing, at least to me, what happens, it almost creates, like, a run-on sentence, right?
Yes.
So, like, this literally, she does not shut the fuck up for, like, 8 lines. And
yes.
A little space would be great.
I agree. And also, as we'll find as we go... She doesn't really, I mean, there's a couple new lyrics, but it's mostly just repeating the same stuff over and over again. Different, maybe, delivery, but...
Yeah.
It's like, why? Why?
Brevity, you know? But there are a couple of quick things I wanted to say. That little open fifth thing on the 4 chord, right? Mm. You know, when you're... So you're on an F chord, and the main melody line's on a G, and then the harmony up top's the C. It's usually something I really like a lot and is, you know, the shortcut to cheese and badass kind of when a song's this saturated already, like
that's the other thing. It's a little, like she, and maybe this is like her producer thing or something, but to make a song longer, you don't just keep adding things.
You have different things. You get fatigue, right?
Yeah.
So it's like if you have a chocolate milkshake and you put ice cream on top and then you put fucking whipped cream in the spring, it's like at some point you got to fucking stop.
That's
right?
What we call a brown sealy.
I'll have to figure out the implications behind that later. And the one other quick note I had is there was a point in this song somewhere we were listening to it in the middle of that timestamp that really reminded me of like a Bright Eyes or a Conor Oberst thing.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that.
But I just wanted to say it sounded similar to my mind. Anyway, let's go
so
to timestamp number 2.
5:48, which is...
About where the original ended, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hey, let's see what happens here. About halfway through the song.
Great.
Anyone? it's like I'm paralyzed by it. I'd like to be my old self again, but I'm still trying to find it. After plaid shirt days and nights when you made me your own, now you mail back my things and I walk home alone. But you keep my old scarf from that very first week, 'cause it reminds you of innocence and it smells like me. You can't get rid of it, remember it all too well. 'Cause there we are again when I loved you so, back before you lost.
She just started the song over, okay? It's not a different section. She started the song over again. It's the same fucking song.
Okay. My first note instantly is like, this could have been a space for...
Space?
Well, yes, but that's what I mean. Yeah, so this could that spot, you know, where that guitar was starting to recycle the chord progression again, which was, you know, really interesting chord progression. Sure.
I definitely want to hear it for 10 minutes.
Honestly, I wouldn't have minded in this situation. I'm trying to remember where this is on the album. Is it deep?
I think it's like the lower half.
Yeah, it's like 2/3 in. I wouldn't have minded like a minute long outro just on that chord progression or something like that. Because
I like that little like the bass part that came in, like that little
with the pick.
That would have been a nice fade out. Yeah, I was thinking, a nice way to end the song.
Yeah. And if it could, honestly, I could have minded it chilling there for like 30 seconds.
I would have been fine with that.
And then a fade out, something like that. But then you heard her big indie breath and you know she's coming back in.
That's how you know she's real.
That's right. Yeah. Well, that's the shortcut to intimacy, just have more breath sounds on the mic, right? And this whole song, I wanted to point out earlier, is like, she has a big, you know, reverb thing as usual, but like, I want to say she's singing closer to a mic or something like that. It just sounds more upfront towards you. She's singing at one person.
Yeah, it's definitely right, intentional. Right, I think as we go more towards the end here, because we're only 3/4 of the way done of this song.
Fantastic.
I kept thinking of Joni Mitchell. Not that she sounds like Joni Mitchell, but I felt like she was trying like a Joni Mitchell thing.
It's funny you mention that. I wanted to mention that, like, on the re-release of 22, her voice reminds me of when Joni Mitchell started to age.
Yes.
Except Joni Mitchell already had the ability to be very...
I think, it's that, and also I just think, because it is more of, like, the metaphorical side, which Joni obviously is
insane.
Master at.
Yeah.
But especially, I guess what you're saying, like, the close mic, she's almost talking to you.
Very intimate. Yeah.
Yeah, so, and she keeps, like... Because Joni Mitchell could just riff forever, too.
Yeah, Joni Mitchell, like, was a musician. Yeah. Taylor Swift may or may not be great singer, great marketer. Joni Mitchell's a pretty complete musician in all the senses.
Exactly. So my next timestamp was a minute later. Let's see what happens here.
So what's it? Like 7 minutes now?
Yeah, 7 minutes.
Oh, cool.
Remember it all too. But the punchline goes, I'll get older, but your lovers stay my age. From when your Brooklyn broke my skin and bones, I'm a soldier who's returning half her weight. And did the twin flame bruise paint you blue? Just between us, did the love affair maim you too? 'Cause in this city's barren cold, I still remember the first fall of snow and how it glistened as it fell. I remember it all too well.
Okay, I think I wrote that one down because I was like, actually it's different, kind of.
It's a halftime feel. I don't know the lyrics of the song. Is this new lyrics?
I think these are the new lyrics, but she had said them previously. In the song already.
Oh, okay.
Earlier. So,
I don't mind a restatement, but
I do when it's at minute the seven. Yeah. Song is a restatement.
At minute 7 and a halftime feel, I mean, the sound was kind of cool. I like the tremolo guitar.
Yeah, definitely. The production part is cool there. I think this is the part I was really thinking of Joni Mitchell on because she's more talky there.
Sure, the delivery is very, not free associated. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I can't remember the word for it, so fuck it.
But like that line where it's like, I'm not good at jokes, but the punchline is, I'm older, but your girlfriend's always stays the same age or whatever. It's like, I get it. What you're doing there, it's real, man. It's real.
Yeah, you're going for it. And that's great.
Yeah, it's
at minute seven, maybe.
Let's see, one of my next one was, oh, and a minute later.
So what's our timestamp? Give it to us.
We're now going to be at 8:20.
Oh, cool.
Let's see what happens. It's like discovering a new song all over again.
Right before you start, though, that whole section was still kind of, and it was kind of, it was cool in this case, but like earlier we were talking about run-on sentences being bad, and now I think it was like, that kind of worked in this segment, because again, it's like the more Joni Mitchell-esque kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So it's all these things that we say are bad, like sometimes can be good in other contexts, and that's what's really annoying about trying to critique music. Is that there's no actual rules, right?
I think, too, I mean, because I obviously don't want to sit here and play a 10-minute song and talk about every minute of it, so we're skipping around, but as you're listening to it, it's like, there's no effort put into, like, the transitions or something like that.
Sure.
So when it does have that drastic change there, that is cool.
Yeah.
But it also just happens in the song. It just...
Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's definitely a different kind of
thing. And it's funny, because in the past, we've referenced, like, songs that I believe the metaphor I used is you just drop a fucking anvil on the chorus.
Yes,
and if you drop an anvil into certain transitions, it may not work as well as other times. And this might be one of those.
Exactly.
Where it just drops into this halftime, basically new everything.
Yes, yeah.
I think it's a new image. Like, it just creates a new stereo everything in your
definitely.
Brain.
But yeah. Anyway,
next section, 8:20.
Almost there, guys. Venus did the love affair meme you all to it. Just between us, do you remember it all to it? Just between us, I remember it all. So how many times do you think she could have ended that in that little, like, 40 seconds we just listened to there? I think about every four bars it could have ended.
Yeah,
and then
pretty
it
much,
kept
yeah.
going.
This is like the never-ending tag. This is like April in Paris when you keep counting in the
That's
tune
exactly
back.
What it's like.
Yeah, so the first thing I wrote in my version of all caps, because I have shitty handwriting, I don't know why this jumped out to me. This sounds like a Christian rock song now.
Oh, shit, it totally does.
Totally does. I don't know... And when the backup singers come in too, you can be like, there's something about Jesus. You know
all
what I mean?
Too well. Yeah.
I know God all too well. Right, whatever. And that's hilarious to me. I don't know.
Oh my God.
When the backup singers came in, I just wanted to jump off the nearest
it's
balcony.
Like all the orchestration in that part too. I mean, throughout the whole song too, but especially the last half of it. Like all the fucking strings and like horns in there. It's like... This is ridiculous. Like,
yeah.
This is just so...
Well, and that's the thing. It almost contrasts with this kind of intimate vibe she's going for, right?
It does. Yeah. So it's like they maybe could try to do like an epic Beatles thing almost or something. Mm-hmm. And like, it's not...
It's not.
Not
it's
working,
not working.
Not working.
Yeah, it's oversaturated with stuff. And this song, you know, is, again, like we're going to say a million times, but it's very metaphorical. It's very... She's up with you personally. It's very relatable, right? It's the idea.
I know. I dated Jake Gyllenhaal once.
And... Great. So it's very relatable. But then when you have large string lines and then when you have, you know, three guitars and different things, it may not support your message being an intimate love or not love song. You know what I mean?
I know. I feel again, like I feel like there's so many missed opportunities.
Yeah.
This could be cool. Someone could make this cool. Someone could take this song, make it 10 minutes and do something interesting with it.
Like Joni Mitchell.
Joni Mitchell. I don't know. Last time stamp, 9:20.
Cool.
So the last minute of the song is where it actually starts to end finally. It does take a full minute to end.
Okay.
I don't know if we'll make it that far.
Nope, I'm not going to. Before we start that though, that little synth line in that middle of that line made me want to die. That's all we get. That's all the critique, you know, and insight.
You should kill yourself.
Oh, it's good to be back. Oh, baby. We're back reviewing music. It's been a year, dude. Why did we stop doing this? I forget.
Oh, because you like moved to Oregon.
Oh,
you fucking
oh that's
asshole.
Right. I moved to Oregon.
Yeah,
right.
Jake's
We're not
fault.
In my apartment.
It's Jake's fault.
Yeah. My bad. All right.
All right. Here we go.
Yep. 9:20.
The ending. I can't. Okay, here we go.
Sacred friend.
I didn't mind that much, actually.
After 10 minutes, yes, that's I felt like...
I didn't make it through this.
They could have given us a little more. I mean, yeah, it's a fine fade-out ending. It's fine.
Yeah.
It's competent.
This would have been nice at 5 minutes, maybe. Yeah.
Yes.
When did we... Which timestamp was it? Was like, this would be a nice time for like the instrumental fade-out thing. I want to say it was the second one at like 6:20 or something.
6:35, I think. Yeah. Yes.
That would have been the time for this. Even then, it's a little, little much.
It just... Essentially she had two ideas for the song. It's like the main one, and then this long, like, halftime fade-out thing.
Which Christian Rock Center.
Yeah, which is, like, 4 minutes long.
Yeah.
And that's all we get. And it just ends. I don't know. I would have liked more of a final statement,
sure,
I guess, at some
yeah.
point, because it never does that. It just da-da-da-da-da-da over and just over and over and over at the end, and just, and that's what you get.
Yeah. I don't know. Part of me doesn't mind this, like, reimagined version that much, but, like, I just... Yeah, you're right. It's just a big missed opportunity.
It is. It's honestly...
That's the problem. Because, like, it's not bad in and of itself.
It's not. Though, again, I will say, if you sit there and listen to the whole thing straight through, it is long.
Yeah. Do you feel its length?
You really do. I kept thinking it was ending.
Yeah.
And it never did. And it didn't... That's not a good thing. It didn't make me, like, yeah. Oh, shit. Just, yeah.
Yeah, fake ending in April of Paris is hilarious. Right? Actually, even that's annoying as fuck, right?
No, it is. It is.
But...
I don't know, I don't know, of course I was reading some terrible AI written review about it, and they said something along the lines of, like, really, she, you know, divides the song into four new sections, and it's great how she's willing to reimagine. It's like,
yeah.
No, she just fucking keeps saying it over and over again, yeah. Nothing happens. But hey, longest number one song ever.
That's right. Good for her.
Good for Taylor.
Yep.
Good for Taylor.
And again, this is not a bad song.
No.
It's just long and shitty.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I just, again, even the original one I feel is like a little long.
It's yeah.
Not my favorite kind of song she does anyway, but like even that one, I'm like, okay, fucking 5 minute ballad, fine, whatever.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
Let's stretch that out.
Yep. Well, the other Taylor Swift song I have notes on. Actually, I have notes on a couple more.
Oh, do you? Do you want to actually go through them?
No.
Okay.
Because one of them's the title track.
Oh, no.
And the title track.
I refuse.
Is so bad.
But that's not even has to do with Taylor's version. That song just sucks.
No, exactly. Yeah. No, this is both versions are terrible. And that's what makes me call into question the fact that this is... We talked about this briefly yesterday. What is an album anymore?
So we're going to restart the episode now.
Yeah.
We're Taylor style, okay?
Yeah.
No, I mean... At the end of the day, it's a pop album. Pop albums are hits and filler.
Yeah, collection of songs that are good, and then you have the songs that didn't quite make it. And then you have the songs that didn't quite make it again, and then you re-release them as a deluxe edition. That's another whole can of worms. Why is this deluxe edition 2 hours and 10 minutes long full of songs you don't want to hear?
Someone wants to hear them, apparently.
Yeah, I guess so. That makes me sad.
Well, I'm reminded of when a year ago we talked about Taylor Swift and folklore and how there was like 7 different versions of folklore.
Yeah.
So I guess that's just what you do these days.
I guess it's all about like volume of content. It's kind of the new approach.
Yeah.
And it makes sense in our current marketplace, right?
It does. It does. Because, I mean, really the only people buying your music are like the diehard
the
fans.
Rabbits, yeah.
Yeah. And so the more things you have for them to buy, they'll buy.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Totally.
It's just.
It's a little sad.
I don't know. I mean, this is just like, this is a stupid thing to say, but it's like, you can't treat this as art.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's not, even though the narrative around this kind of stuff is always like, Taylor's proud return, and like that person who wrote a whole diary entry crying over it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like,
this isn't.
I feel bad, but no, it's this millionaire
yes.
who's like reclaiming her songs, and you know they're good songs.
This is not.
But it's not.
This is not like a struggling artist from the Bronx, right?
Yeah.
This is not someone.
And all too well, she says Brooklyn broke.
That's right.
So.
That's right. But Brooklyn, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
The Bronx. Right? No, so like this is not someone. This is not like your friend, right?
Yeah.
Taylor Swift is not your friend.
Which is fine. I mean, that's what celebrities have been doing forever.
Yeah.
That's like the whole point.
But and I like Taylor Swift.
I do too. It's just ridiculous how like, there's no reason that 10-minute song should be a number one hit. Like,
yeah. Yeah,
like really?
It should be the filler track.
Does anyone, do people actually like it? Like, or do they just,
do they like it?
Think they like it? I don't, like. Well,
so what they do, it's like a self-fulfilling thing. They know they should. because it's 10 minutes long and it's interesting.
Yes.
It is interesting to have a 10-minute long song. Originally it was 5, and then you doubled it and you did some weird stuff with it. You half-timed it, you restated it in a different way. And in theory, that's cool. But in execution, it's lame and doesn't work. Yes,
there's no way if this was anyone besides Taylor Swift, it would be a thing.
Yeah, no, if this was... Even if this was Katy Perry, like, this
no,
wouldn't
no
work.
One care. No, no one cares. No one would care.
Yeah. But Taylor Swift has done a great job presenting herself as someone...
She's a master.
Yeah.
She really is.
So that's really what it comes down to, is people want to believe that the song is really good and interesting and meaningful at 10 minutes as it was at 5.
Yes. Just but, because, what's that whole thing? It's like, more content, yep, you know?
More content. That's, I mean, what's that quote about social media? It's, you're the product and they're selling your time, right? Mm. To advertisers or whatever, right? And this isn't exactly the same, but the fact that everyone's just going for content and, you know, trying to produce as much as possible gives me similar vibes as that.
Well, thank God we're not, like, spending hours listening and talking about this or anything.
Yeah, actually, I guess when you think about it, we are taking a song that is 10 minutes long and turning it into a 40-minute episode. Listeners at home, we have a question for you. Are we the problem?
Are we the baddies?
Are we the bad people in the world? We might be.
It's like you were talking to me yesterday about that guy who made the YouTube video and then the rebuttal and then the rebuttal of the rebuttal. That was like 11 hours long. Yeah. It's like we are stoking the fire here.
We are stoking the fire. Yeah. And that's the nature of being a critic, is you're by definition kind of an asshole.
Yes.
And like, what makes our perspective good? The fact that we, you know music theory and are good at like playing instruments?
Has nothing to do with this music.
Not at all.
Nothing at all.
So, like, what business do we have? I get it. Like, why are we cool enough to talk about it?
Tune into our new philosophy show, Life Sucks and I Want to Die, for more insightful conversations this.
But to get to that, you have to follow us on our Twitter, Music Sucks Cast. At Music Sucks Cast. Our Twitter is going to be lit again. We promise we're done being...
Like and subscribe.
We're on YouTube. We're filming this on a ghetto-ass setup with a GoPro and a light that, like, has a white t-shirt over it.
Don't show them behind the scenes.
Taylor
would never do that.
That's for the Patreon subscribers only, right? Anyway. There's one more song I have notes on.
Okay.
I don't really want to play it.
That's fine.
Yeah.
I'm a little tailored out.
I'm a little tailored out too, which is why. But one of the songs is almost like a remix. And
which one is that?
It was called Girl at Home. Yeah, Girl at Home. It's called Girl at Home. The original's like, you know, your Taylor. And then the next one's like almost like a new wavy kind of thing. Ooh. Yeah. And it's actually, I say that, the difference isn't that extreme.
Right.
But like,
it's a more noticeable than some of the other
parts. Yes, it's much more noticeable than the other stuff. And it worked for me.
Okay.
Not really, but like, it's on the original, it was a filler track.
Gotcha.
And on the new one, it's a filler track, but it functions slightly differently in that it's kind of new and cool.
Okay.
They tried something.
I mean, that's what a good filler should be. It should be...
It should be adventurous.
It's forgettable, but at least it kind of serves something different, right?
And I will always go back to one of my favorite albums ever for its filler, and Synchronicity 2. And its filler is fucking insane.
There you go. That's like, what a good filler. It's like, there should be no hope with this ever being played
exactly.
on the radio.
And it should also be kind of bad.
Yes.
But like, in the weirdest way imaginable.
Yes, exactly.
Like, do I want to hear Sting talk about dinosaurs for 4 minutes? Not really, but I'm going to. And it's track number 2.
Okay, well, that's a different story. I don't know about that. To wrap up our Taylor, we're going to tailor it down a little here.
Taylor down.
Do we want to talk about the terrible AI reviews real quick?
Yeah,
this is somewhat unrelated.
This is pretty much my rant of the week, so.
Okay.
We might as well just.
Shall we jump
into the
rants?
The rants of the week. My rants of the week has to do with reviews and on the internet how disastrous the online marketplace of. Not even music. So this is any form of media ever.
Yes.
Literally any type of thing you want to see. Like if you Google a review, like Cinema Blend, for instance, if you're going to look for a movie review on Cinema Blend, you're going to find 4 paragraphs of nothing, right? Of fluff, mm-hmm. right? Of garbage. And then you're going to find a paragraph and a half on the actual movie. And then you're going to find a list of credits, but doled out in a.
Yes.
Specific way. And this is when I was looking up reviews of Taylor Swift, this is all I could find were these. And then you have like actual websites like Pitchfork that I guess try.
Yeah.
And that's all I can say about Pitchfork is like, they don't have half their articles written by a bot, but
only a third.
Only a third. No. So like this, it's fucking cancer and I hate it. I'm trying to read a review and then I have, it's the same format. Every website.
It is.
What is it? Variety. American songwriter, fucking, I have notes on this somewhere, but now I wrote a bunch of notes today. Pop Sugar.
Oh, like, yeah, all those.
All these shit fucking websites that will just pump out a review for clicks.
Yeah.
And then, like, half of it's written by an AI, and then, like, you have a little context for your actual readers who are somehow still reading. And then you have the rest of the AI-generated article, which is a list of credits, and, like, but with slightly enforced language that makes it seem like it's not.
It's so bizarre, because it's, like, long sentences that don't actually say anything ever. It's so bizarre.
Yeah, it's like a 10-minute version of All Too Well. No, it's the most frustrating thing in the world.
I was thinking about this, so, you know, and this is all not too long ago, you know, back in the day before the internet, mm-hmm. you had reviews in, like, physical media.
Sure.
Like, you'd have to get a magazine or a newspaper or something. And then you had sort of, like, the DIY zines that people would put out.
Yeah.
But at least that still had, like, if you were doing that, you actually hopefully knew something or were a writer of some kind. And then the internet came and people could start having blogs. And back in the day, blogs were really cool.
Yeah.
Because the only people that would actually put effort into a blog were people who were, like,
really, really into it.
Yeah. Yeah. And so I found a lot of great shit on blogs. Like, I guess even Scroofy was a blog.
Yeah, I mean, he still is a blog for all intents and purposes.
He just posted his thoughts on Ukraine.
I actually read
a
large chunk of that. Yeah.
Bet it was very insightful.
You know, actually, Pierre Scroofy, he does go slightly deeper than the average person, which is very nice.
Yeah, it is true.
So it was less irritating to read than everyone I see on Facebook
who thinks
they're a geopolitics expert now.
Well, actually, that's a good point. And so now at the point, it's your grandma on Facebook writing shit, or they realize they can monetize it through clicks and ads, so they can just boop, boop, boop. Well, you were saying too, like, all sports reviews are now, like, AI written.
That's my least favorite thing ever. So sports recaps on websites like MLB.com and the major ones. Even ESPN, I want to say, does this kind of stuff. Like, your major sports recaps of games will be 100% AI generated because the language is so easy to make. You have a certain criteria for, like, someone who has a good game. Let's say LeBron had a triple-double or whatever, right? Then you say, like, you have a script, like, you have 10 different options, and it's like, LeBron James had another amazing night at local arena, right? And it and I see this pattern now. Once I discovered that in sports writing, like, 5 or 6, 7, 8 years ago, then I found this pattern seep into other things. And I'm like, I'm 90% sure it's, like, the basis for half of our internet journalism.
Yes.
For things, because, like, no one actually wants to read full game recaps. So they're just there for people to find the stats real fast. And it's the same for music reviews, right? No one actually cares about a critic's opinion. They just want to see that their thing is going to be good.
Yes, I agree.
Or bad, whatever.
Well, I wonder too, I mean, like, obviously there's people like the Needle Drop guy, for instance. Mm-hmm. Like, he has a following. People actually care what he thinks. Mm-hmm. And then there's people like us, obviously, really people that just worship our opinions on everything.
Yeah, they love us, man.
But then, like, who's reading this shit? Who's besides us?
Well, no, that's the thing. It's a lot of people, but no one's actually reading it.
But, like,
it doesn't stick.
I don't understand the mindset. Like, man, that new Taylor Swift album is awesome. Let me Google Taylor Swift Red review. Oh, that article looks interesting. Like, who does that? Do people do that? People must do it. Or they don't exist.
There's a market, right?
Yeah.
If there's a market, people are doing transactions, right? I don't get
it. I mean, and besides us kind of just doing cursory sort of Googling, seeing what people look at.
Yeah.
If I actually wanted to research a topic, I wouldn't go there. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, you might start there.
I might go Wikipedia first, yes. And then
which, of course, we were told not to do as high school students, right?
Yep. Yeah. Thanks, Grandma. Okay, Boomer. Okay.
But that's pretty much the rant, is that all online articles that represent forms of media or review forms of media are garbage written by AI that no one should ever read and that are a cancer on the internet as a totality. What do you think?
Amen, brother.
Thanks. All right. What's your rant, fam? I bet you have quite a few.
I'm doing a shout out, actually.
Oh, that's a good kind of rant.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What a guy.
I'm shouting out a book. Yes, might surprise you to know that we read. We read. I know you probably can't tell by the way we talk about things, but we do, in fact, read books.
Yeah, I swear I've actually read some of these, maybe. Question mark.
So here's where I would hold the book up if I remember to bring it with me. But
are you going to try and Photoshop
for the for the people listening on Spotify, I'm holding up a book right now. this book is Major Labels, A History of Popular Music and 7 Genres by, I'm sorry, I'm going to butcher this name.
Yep.
So
I went to your house in Eugene for New Year's Eve, and I saw this on your bedstand or on your coffee table or whatever. Yep. And I was like, this looks interesting.
It's really good.
Really? Okay.
I mean, I read a lot of music books mm-hmm. and things like that, and usually they're just... If you weren't interested, you probably wouldn't read this, read those kind of books. This sure. one, I think, like...
Has
it... it's... Khalifa, I'm sorry. If you listen to this, I'm sorry. But he was the... He wrote a lot for, like, the New York Times, and I think he's the New Yorker music critic now, too. He's done a lot of shit throughout the years. He's interviewed... He actually mentions he had a really nice interview with Morgan Wallen.
For those of you who don't know, we did an episode on Morgan Wallen's Dangerous, the double album.
The very creative title, Double Album.
Yeah, and I think that's episode like 37. Go back and look at that. It's
point being, he knows his shit, okay? Yeah. So he's like a really respected reviewer.
I'm plugging ourselves.
But it's really interesting. So basically, it's about popular music mm-hmm. only, which actually is a topic I don't usually read about.
Totally.
But so it's kind of interesting in that his basically each chapter is one genre. So he'll go through the history of rock, and then he went through the history of like R&B, and then country, and so on like that.
Cool. So it actually is seven genres.
It's seven genres, yes. And it's just really creatively written. In a sense, it's like a textbook because it's just information.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like an enjoyable textbook to read.
That's what I was going to say. Like, I read the first few pages, and it was all about a love letter to Paul McCartney and how this girl was, like, trying to really
get.
And it was the writing style was not of a textbook, but, like, the way information was presented was like a textbook.
Exactly. So
it was better language.
Better language.
But it's the still same, like, quality exactly. of information.
Exactly, yeah. There's plenty of dates and names and shit like that, but it's almost like reading a story.
Yeah.
And he's really good at sort of... Usually I don't really like it when an author puts himself into a history book of whatever. Sure. He does it really well. He does it subtly. He'll weave it in, like just a paragraph in the middle of something else.
Like where he was during this time?
Yes, because, okay. I mean, he's done a lot of shit. Or even, like, in the punk chapter, for instance, that was, like, his big thing when he was in college. He was, like, super into punk.
Is this guy British? Or, did he live in the UK? Or?
I think his parents come from South Africa, I believe, and he grew up here.
Okay, in America.
Yes. But he really puts himself in the story just enough where it's not obnoxious and kind of gives you that real
flavor.
Like, yeah, it's really well done. And it's also, even though it's textbooky, he jumps around a lot, but in an interesting way. So it's not like year by year kind of thing.
Oh, interesting.
It's more, here's this band, and then this is how this kind of changed things,
sure,
and blah, blah, blah. And then the next part will be like, at the same time that was happening, or like
more
years later, like
more associative, yeah.
Yeah, it's real highly recommend. Probably my favorite music book I've read in a long
time.
Nice,
dude. So, I'm gonna have to get that then.
It's really good.
The first,
really,
like, good. I read the first four pages, I'm like, wow, this is cool. And mm-hmm. then we were, you know, it was like 3 a.m. on New Year's Eve, and I was like, I'm gonna be drunk now. But it was really cool.
It's good to, like, one more thing just to keep going on about this. Like I said, it's genre by genre, but he does a really good job of sort of connecting the dots as you go,
okay,
in a way, because it starts with rock, and then you get into R&B, and then country, and it's like, that's kind of an odd order to go by, you know? But as you, like, get more into the country, he'll bring it back to, like, and so this, it's like apparent what he thought about how to structure this, I'm pretty sure,
okay,
in a way. It's still not finished with it yet, but it's...
Okay. I mean, yeah. I'm going to read it. What's the title one more time?
Major Labels, A History of Popular Music and Seven Genres.
That's a good shout out. Mm-hmm. I'm definitely actually going to get that book.
Very good.
Yeah. That brings us to the end of our first post-hiatus episode of Music Sucks and I Want to Die. Please make sure to go onto YouTube.com and find our YouTube channel where we'll post this with our shitty lighting and our horrible setup and all that shit. But it's charming when it's this bad, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's charming, and we're relatable.
We're
really
DIY, like Taylor, dude.
Exactly.
Yeah,
So find us on YouTube. We have a great Twitter where we make fun of music constantly if we ever post at Music Sucks Cast. And, you know, we're on Spotify, TuneIn, Stitcher. Follow us. Do whatever the fuck you want. Tell all your friends about us and make sure that you...
Like our listeners have friends.
Yeah. Like we have listeners. Yeah. Make sure that you get people to, like, flame us on comments so that we can, you know, respond in kind, et cetera, et cetera. But that does it for our first return
You're,
episode.
You're forgetting what have you been listening to this week?
Oh, I forgot! Holy shit!
Wow.
It's been so long.
We're gonna
long.
Have to redo that whole wrap up.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah,
God,
no.
Damn it.
You already got the wrap up, so we're gonna get the listening. What have I been listening to? My listening is Alice Longyu Gao. She is an artist who's American, Chinese, and Japanese.
Were you playing this when we came down from the cruise ship gig? like last summer.
She was one of she was on one of those tracks. So she is I want to say, so it's like not dance, it's like it's electronic. I still don't know the difference between any of those words. Electronica, you know, techno, etc. But like really like irreverent, very bizarre.
Kind of punky.
Little punky. Yeah, a little punky, but also like.
It kind of, I vaguely remember the song we were listening to, and I was just like, whoa.
Yeah.
It's just like, she's spitting.
She's spitting, but like she's spitting about the most inconsequential garbage that's ever happened. So I'm going to recommend, she doesn't really have like. Albums. She did just release an EP, but like
yeah, it's
just,
like electronic music doesn't really do albums, right?
Yeah, they just, she has like 8,000 single releases on Spotify. Just go to her Spotify page, Alice Longyu, Longyu Gao, Gao. It's very strange and really fun to listen to. Some of it's like really bad, but really fun. It never is. It's never not enjoyable. Let's put it that way. What about you?
I've been listening to the album Jewelry by Mikachu and the Shapes, and I believe that they go by a different name now. But on Spotify, it's still under Mikachu and the Shapes. So it's from like 2009, I think. And just nothing special. It's really weird off-kilter pop. Like,
okay.
But to the point where it's like, what?
Is it like dream poppy?
No,
or like, what
it's hard to describe. It's pop music, but there's so much like weird, like sample-y shit. Well, I don't even think they're doing samples. I mean, it's them doing it, but it's like... It's hard to describe. There's a lot of stuff going on, and none of it makes sense, but it's also just, like, quality, like, Britpop songs at the same time.
Word?
Worth a listen. It's odd. It's odd.
Okay, Mikachu and the Shapes.
Yeah.
Jewelry. And Jewelry.
Yep. So we have a YouTube. We have
fuck you. Yeah, so all that shit we talked about earlier, just insert that here. I'm going to make you edit that so you do it here now. No, so yeah, this is Music Sucks and I Want to Die. This is our first post-hiatus episode. Please support us. We're awesome, right? We do good stuff. In the world.
I'm going to end from a great quote by user The Great Red Dragon on Reddit.
Now's the time to turn off this episode right now before.
Anyone else hate the entire thing? Distorted, distant vocals, muted guitars and drums, timing completely of. This is legitimately awful. Every song is totally destroyed sonically.
So, okay. This is, we talked about earlier how, I'm sorry, we have to re-enter.
All Too Well,
this is
your fault. All Too Well, it's never going to end.
No, that's what I was saying. Like, when we were talking about All Too Well, we were like, we're talking about the most minute shit ever, right? And like, people who try to like this song are wrong, but also people who fucking hate it are stupid. Like, this is so not, he's wrong. Like, this
people shouldn't have opinions.
Yeah, people, unless you're as cool as us, you don't get to have opinions. Even our opinions are terrible. I mean,
how do you write timing completely of?
And then you have a real opinion?
Yeah. Well, but also like, no, that's just blatantly false.
Yeah, there's nothing no weird timing,
issues.
They're so tight that it's unbelievable.
Yeah,
right?
And also distorted. Like, none of that's true.
None of that's true.
None of that is
there
true.
There is one song with distortion on the vocals.
Well, that's part, yeah.
But it has less in the new one, so it's even funnier. It's Trouble. Right? Because they had a little less distortion on the vocals in that version than this one. Anyway, that's a stupid
They did have one reply. The timing is the big one I noticed.
I don't think I
understand. What Jake, the fuck do you are they talking kill yourself about? Yet?
Just that's our tagline, right?
If you don't want to kill yourself, you're not going on Reddit.
No, oh, God. So this has been Music Sucks and I Want to Die. I'm Jake.
I'm Matt.
We're back. We're going to be posting episodes hopefully every 2 weeks.
Meh. Month. I'm thinking monthly.
You're thinking month? Yeah. Well, we'll figure it out.
We'll figure it out. But stay tuned.
Subscribe for updates. We will be releasing episodes, we promise.
Yes.
Peace out.
She up all night, got those white boy eyes. When I try to talk her to her, she go.